Here's that EVOC20. Here we have our nothing to say audio in there. Okay, so we're looking at here at the dual waves between 1 and 2. We look through there. We know what that is. We know what that can do. Let's check the difference here. Clicking FM. Now I can change, of course, between the balance between those. Well, what the heck? FM, even though it shows a waveform, it does not allow me to change the waveform because this is carrier and wave 2 is modulator. And the carrier in this instance of FM is always a sine wave. The wave 2 is also a sine wave, but I can change the chorus and fine tuning ratios. That will change that ratio between those. So it's kind of like that FM depth. So that's that harmonic ratio like we had with carrier and modulator on EFM1. So that's how that all kind of is packaged into this little area. Now, the other thing we can do to make it even more confusing, because like I said, every synth is going to get more and more and more and more confusing. So you just have to start thinking about trying to understand the bits and pieces of it. Well, right here we have noise. So I can add noise, just another oscillator creating noise. So there's my noise. And then color of the noise. Let's put this up here. Actually, let's do this and let's do this. Any idea what this color is doing?
We're making it go from white to blue.
Wow. That's amazing. You get an A for the day. Just for the day, though. What do you hear it doing? What is the difference between white noise and blue noise? Totally wrong. It's a high pass. So it's just a filter. That's only your difference between that. So I'm just adding an amount of noise, and then I'm either adding or taking away, or passing or not passing. I'm not really adding. Passing or not passing the highs, and that's all that that's doing to change that. So that's pretty cool. So pretty normal. If I go back here, that is independent of dual or FM. So that makes that pretty cool to use. All right. Let's continue to hear for just a second. We have attack release. So this is our ADSR, our volume envelope, but it's an AR. We're pretty familiar with that by now. So a very simplified volume envelope for that portion of the synth. Let's look up over here. Global, we have obviously what we've had in all the synths. Polyphonic, meaning multiple notes. Let's take that off because that's really annoying. Sixteen, all the way down to mono. Mono by itself. So when I hit the next note, it jumps to that note. But what's cool about that is I can kind of do that pedaling effect so that I can have it jump back down to that other note. Legato. Now, notice I can unison. When we had that in other synths, we had the ability to put two or more of the same instance of that synth together to give it a fuller sound. Of course, it's going to also give us a bigger volume, so watch out if you are overloading your volume. All of a sudden, we're quite a bit louder. Notice in poly, because I have multiples, I have half the amount because it's going to only allow, if I want 16 voices and I do two at the same time, I'm going to run out quicker. So let's do this here. totally distorting the synth. If hopefully you can hear that. An effect you probably all will use all the time. So there's our global settings for that. Yes, we do have here, if we come back, we do have that same kind of filter. Now we're in dual mode. We haven't really seen this type of a filter in an FM synthesis. EFM1 doesn't necessarily have that kind of system. So it's adding that kind of subtractive synth of having that filter in there that can affect those things as well. We'll pull those down and get those out of there. Looking at this area here, again, global settings, you can detune the overall instrument. You can create analog like pitch variances. So if I'm in a mono single voice, this isn't really going to matter, but if I'm in a mono single voice and get something back there, I'm not going to notice a whole lot of analog because there's nothing, there's only a single voice there. There's not a lot of detuning that can happen. But if I have more voices available and I make my synth more complex. It will, depending on where the settings are for the different parts of the synth side of this, it will allow for like selective background detuning of certain functions of the oscillators. It's kind of random. It's like that random setting where it was 0 to 100%. It kind of just does that detuning randomly as you make it available more 100% or less as you're down at zero. And glide, we've had in all of these where it allows you to glide from one pitch to the other. So that's pretty normal. So this whole section here should seem fairly normal to us. Might be a little bit restrictive in how we create some of our sounds, but we have that same idea of intensity if we're in FM and a modulator and a carrier and two waves adding together like two separate oscillators if we do it for dual mode. Now the cool or the real part of this whole thing is the vocoder section. So let's go through that. And the vocoder section is this whole section here. So that kind of middle section with those angled lines and stuff. And what you're looking at is the analysis part of the vocoder and then where those changes and how those changes are dealt with after that it's been analyzed. Number of bands includes the number of these cuttings or slices of the audio that we're putting into it. So we're taking the side-chained audio, we're bringing it into this analysis, it's going to analyze it, and then we're going to be able to change some things with it and change it either very narrowly, like with lots of little itty-bitty bands on the EQ range, or with very few and they're big, wide bands. And you can see that this slider at the top controls the frequency range of that vocoder section. So at best, I'm in the 75 to 8,000 hertz range is where I'm going to affect stuff. And I can change those bands by sliding up on that band area over there. 5 is the smallest that I have. Now notice that the bands are actually the places that it slices, which I find to be a little misleading because the bands you're looking at is actually the range. So 5 really means 6, which is kind of weird. Now, to hear this, take my noise off. Okay. I hear the synth because I'm set to synth on the signal. And we knew that before analysis, if I hit spacebar to play.
I have nothing to say.
If I switch this to vocoder, I play the synth. What the heck? What's going on? I have to play the project to get the vocoded side-chained sound to play. So it's going. It's not necessarily going to do anything until I... Let's do this a little quicker. Let's do this. We'll make it smaller.
Okay.
So it's playing that vocoded sound, that audio underneath. It's analyzing it and having the control be played with the sound of the synth. The synth generated sound analyzed through that vocoded sound. The bigger number of bands, the more true to that original sound it's going to be. Because it's splitting that into more and more and more EQ ranges and analyzing them independently. So obviously it's like taking a better sample rate. And you can play chords. Now, let's look at a couple of examples just to hear what that's going to be like. So if you go to vintage vocoder, you go like to clear voice vocoder. Let me do this here. Or Galactic Warriors. Now some things are happening here, and we'll talk about that in a second. Anybody never hear that kind of sound before? Like you've heard it all, right? Okay. Dustin, you heard that before? Okay. All right, so what can we do with this area? Now, it's a little bit weird because as you start talking about what this means, formant stretch and formant shift, you have to kind of know what that is. So I have two good definitions for you. A formant is a concentration of acoustic energy around a particular frequency in the speech wave. There are several formants, each at a different frequency, roughly one in each 1,000 hertz band. Or to put it differently, formants occur at roughly 1,000 hertz intervals. Each formant corresponds to a resonance in the vocal tract. The other definition, which is a little bit easier, is a formant is a peak in the frequency spectrum of a sound. In the context of human voices, formants are the key component that enables humans to distinguish between different vowel sounds, based purely on the frequency of the sounds. Formants in human speech and singing are produced by the vocal tract, with most vowel sounds containing four or more formants. So the formant is like the sound, the individual oscillators, if you want to think of it that way, that make up the speech, specifically the vowels that we speak. Consonants are shorter and have less that makeup. So if you think of A, E, I, O, U, there's at least four parts to that that make up that sound. And when it comes through this analysis, I can change the way those frequencies, as they're analyzed, are dealt with through this vocoder. Does that kind of make sense? Okay, so we can stretch the formants. And as I move this, you see what happens. Let's go back to here, because this one's a little bit clearer. Let's move that back to zero. So if you can picture that as like the EQ band is being analyzed and then expanded, I should hear that sound or that vocal a lot clearer depending on the number of bands that I have to begin with as I increase those. So if I want something more metallic, less recognizable, I want a lower number of bands, and if I stretch that formant in various directions, it'll take it either to a brighter or a more focused, darker kind of sound. So all it's doing is taking those and stretching them one way or the other. Hopefully that makes sense. Form and shift kind of is like a filter in that it takes and analyzes them, but then shifts them to higher or lower EQ register. Now all of that, like I said, is controlled by this frequency range, and that range can be adjusted from one side to the other, and that range can be moved. So think of all that as, it's not really a filter, but it kind of acts like that. It's obvious that as I go higher, I'm filtering out the lows, including less of them. And as I get that formant shift and stretch to a smaller pattern, it's going to be less and less recognizable. So you have to kind of decide what's that ultimate goal that you're going for in that sound. So let's see if we can do this, and then we'll come back to this. And again, we'll pull that back out of there. And then, of course, resonance is where, how much is that resonance around those? I like to think of them more as like combs or like wires that cut through those. I know it talks about bands and it's talking about the space in between, but it's really, the resonance is gonna be at those band cutting places. So you can get a pitch change, but you're not getting any kind of speed change, obviously. Purely because it's focusing that towards a higher frequency range. Now look on either end, I can change those from just a normal band pass to a high and low pass. And that all that says is the last band use a low pass, the top band use a high pass. Depending on the sound and how you have it stretched and how you have it shifted is gonna make that different sound. So you have to kind of decide how that's gonna work. Now, as always, we want to get more complicated. So we have this UV detection mode, which is those voiced and unvoiced formants. So like if I say A, the vowel A, the voiced formant is the like that A sound. The unvoiced formants are the other three that make up that sound A. I know, which is kind of weird because we're like, it's the letter A, it's just you're saying A, but it's made up of kind of like, we have like four oscillators, if you want to think about it that way, that are making up that sound in our voice box. So this will say, how sensitive is it to those voiced and unvoiced formants? In this case, it's not a whole lot of difference. That clear is pretty clear. You can kind of hear it. And you have some variations as to how you do that. Does it work on this sensitivity and level? Do you use it at all? Does it just work on the noise, the sound that you're bringing in? In this case, I have nothing to say. Does it work on both the sound created with the synth and what you're bringing in through that kind of filter system? And then is it a blend, which is, it's kind of looking at it and deciding, I have this much frequency here, I have this much frequency there. The computer kind of decides by itself what that blend is gonna be. So that one's, we lose some control over that. Does that make sense? It's all very ethereal. When we go off, in this case, this one's pretty clean, so we're not going to hear a whole lot of difference. And we've had this before, so we went to this vocal signal. That's how we're hearing the vocoder. This is just overall output of our amplitude. And these are the chorus settings, again. So we had ensemble 1 and 2 before. So again, chorus is adding a multiple of what we have already, like unison, and it's detuning that second or third or fourth or whichever one that we're working with. Say, And then how far that stereo width, so you can imagine the two, if there's two waves and they're slightly detuned, how far is it pulling those two apart, giving you kind of like an expander. Now you can start to hear the low one, which maybe I couldn't hear before because it's more over there. So far, makes sense? So, and all we're doing is sidechaining that, and it's still playing the whole time, and the synth is creating how those sounds work. All right, we didn't really look at analysis. Sidechain analysis, this will look at how fast or how slow does it look at the audio that's being sidechained in, and does it allow, it's like a volume envelope where it says it can change how long, how quick or how slowly that comes in. So if we crank that up, so here I'm putting the key down. It's a real short piece of audio that we're bringing in, but you can hear how it slowly fades everything up. So it's almost like an ADSR, but again, just attack and release. Same thing. Freeze is really freaky, because if I get to a point where I get a sound where I really, really like it, of course I grabbed it at a point where there was absolutely no sound, it will freeze that, and every time I play the key, it will be just that sound. So I'll try to catch one. Maybe useful, maybe not. And yes, freeze is automatable, so you can use freeze with automation. And if that wasn't enough, because you're probably like, oh my gosh, I'm completely overwhelmed already because it can do so many different things, then we add as well an LFO like we had before. So a low frequency oscillator that will do stuff, that will change the rate of stuff. So here we have, of course, the waveform that we want to use, and we have a pitch LFO and a shift, a formant shift. So it's like taking this and moving that around with an LFO. So we have a waveform, we have a rate, and we have an intensity. So there it is with nothing. Let's take that chorus off. Let's bring that down. So we have that LFO. Now we're affecting it. Shift, formant shift, although we don't see it, formant shift is moving it to the rate of that LFO, using that as the waveform. So you can start creating rhythmic effects as well. So all the different waveforms that we looked at, triangles and squares and sawtooth and a sample and hold, and then a pure random pulse width. So it's just going to change in between all of them. So that's all this side. Pitch, we can also change as well. So that's just pitch overall with rate. Let's bring that down. Again, waveform selected. Now, let's just use this as intensity together. So this is going to set where that happens. Or synced to the beat, to the grid. And this is that intensity, but of course split is intensity via modulation wheel. So this person really has nothing to say. Did you gather yet that yet? I have nothing to say. Make sense? Now, you've probably figured out, if you've done anything with a vocoder before, that it doesn't have to always be this kind of audio. So you won't be able to do this, Jeremy, because yours will go to index. But if I go to my beats and I just come in here and I go to beats and I say, like, I don't know how loud this is going to be. It's probably going to be very loud. that's not very interesting, is it? Okay. So now I put that down, and I mute that. Well, I won't really need to mute it, but I'm going to take this, and I'm going to same thing, no output, and I'm going to go back to my vocoder, and this time I'm going to sidechain the big beat. Come on. Of course, it helps to play it. Remember, I have to have it to vocoder. That sounds pretty weird, but add some white noise. More white noise, more noise, I should say, and the more open the filter, the more percussive it's going to sound. So the sound is acting like we would normally think of using a sidechain to control a bass, another drum. Sometimes you'll put just a straight synth sound, and then you can sidechain a rhythm, and it'll go, and it'll create that sequence for it. Now we're actually using that full beat and vocoding it to make it do stuff. We can change all the parameters again. Slow LFO on pitch. Not. Notice it's not re-triggering. That LFO is just continuing. Makes sense? Austin's like, enough! I'm overwhelmed! These are pretty basic still. I tell you, when we get to sculpture and alchemy, you're gonna be like, pow. So again, for me, if you can figure out the sounds you're making with the synth, this is pretty easy in this section. If you can bring something in and sidechain it and change it a little bit, higher the bands, the clearer it's gonna be, lower the bands, the more robotic and junky it's gonna be. If you can do that much, I think that's pretty good. If you can start working with LFO, that's great. If not, it's no big deal. If you want to chorus stuff, just make sure as you make stuff that your volumes are lower, because the output of this is you start doing unisons and higher voices and all this extra stuff. This is going to get pretty loud. So you want to make sure it's not distorting unless you're like Brian and you want to have super distorted sound. Then just overdrive the heck out of it, because that's the sound you're looking for. Questions on that? So your goal, you'll see in the assignment, if you look at the assignment, it talks about, again, 2 to 3 minute tune, or this time a 2 to 3 minute tune. I think we were lower before.
I don't think we had a time limit for the other one.
5 instances of vocoder or just one?
I'm not telling you how much you have to do of the vocoder, because it could get pretty ridiculous if you use more, but whatever you want to do. So this is using both of those synths. And for next week. Now, I wanted to also point out that if we look at our syllabus.
After next week is spring break, right?
It's a coming, closer and closer. So we are here. So next week you're going to present that, and we're going to talk about ES2, and then we're going to have production music where I always give you a set of instructions. You have to do this for this, it's for this client, or here's the thing that I'm looking for in the music. Use these synths to do that. Spring break portfolio week. So you have that next project is going to go through portfolio week, and we'll meet again on the 9th, or week 9, not sorry, not the 9th. We'll meet on week 9 when you'll present that, and then we'll get to sculpture. and alchemy. And then you'll be all set to create like a crazy person. Sound good? Can never tell with you guys. You're all kind of mesmerized. Either you're tired and bored, or you're like, this is too much. Or you're like, what's that?
Or just tired.
Or I want to get working. Just stop talking. I want to start playing.
Did Scott tell you when I was late today?
Yeah, you got all kinds of cash. Because it's your birthday.
Oh,
happy birthday.
Thank you.
He said you had to go to the bank to deposit those wads of cash you got for presents.